Brooklyn for a couple of years.
If everyone will find a seat, we'll get started straight away. We're very, very pleased to have the governor here today. I met the governor about a year ago. This guy is just so terrific. So I'm very happy to have him on our presidential candidate series, and I think you will enjoy meeting Governor Bullock. But first, before we do that, that's not an announcement saying we need to leave the building.
No, that's just a test.
Test whether we have to leave the building at some point yet.
As most of you know, you are members of the Common Good. The Common Good is about encouraging the best of American values. And that includes reasoned discourse, that includes citizen engagement, that includes voting, encouraging others to vote, and doing many other kinds of initiatives. And one of the initiatives that we're going to be starting is called My American Story. And we're going to encourage our members and beyond to share their stories about how they came to be American. We all have very, very diverse backgrounds. We want to celebrate what it is to be an American, because we all share that background of coming from somewhere else. And we're proud of that diversity. So we've already have received a number of very, very beautiful and interesting and moving stories, some of whom are the folks are here. But I hope you will consider sharing your quintessential American story, because every single one of those stories is quintessentially American. I also want to acknowledge a few people in the room. First, our folks who have served in public service, and I know there are other people who have served in public service, but two distinguished citizens here, Dick Ravitch, who was Lieutenant Governor of New York, and Joe Polino, a former ambassador of Malta from the United States. So thank you both for being here today. I also, since the press is under siege, under assault, and around the globe, and even here in the United States, we always acknowledge our current and lapsed members of the press. So I want to
a lapsed member of the press.
Yes,
I like that.
We have a lapsed member over here, very distinguished lapsed member, Jim Hogue. Thank you for being here, and Lloyd Grove. Thank you so much for all that you do. And Tom Rogers, thank you for what you've done with the media and the press. Some of us I also want to be sure that you know about our events that are coming up. We usually have a quiet summer. This summer it's not so quiet. We're very, very pleased to have Governor Bullock, but we will have Seth Moulton, another presidential candidate in the Hamptons, and just a couple of weeks. We're going to have Michael Wolff talk about his new book, Siege. We will have Frank Luntz, a very prominent Republican consultant with Ari Melber, late in the summer, and a number of other events coming up. So watch that space, and please sign up early, because they tend to sell out. But now I'd like you to introduce our esteemed guest. Governor Bullock is really special. First of all, he won in a Republican state. He won in a red state. So if nothing else, he has something to teach Democrats on how to win in a Republican state and how to govern with people of across the aisle. He's really done a remarkable job there. The other thing that's unusual about Governor Bullock is that Montana is very unique in that they worked very hard to get dark money out of their system. After the Gilded Age, there were wealthy people who could practically buy senators and state legislators. And Montana passed very strict laws to keep money out of politics. Citizens United has made that very, very hard, even in a state like Montana that's worked so hard to keep that from happening. So Governor Bullock has made that a very special part of his race for the presidency. But he's really interested in a number of issues and has pushed those forward, and I'd like you to hear from the governor himself about all of that. We're very excited to have you, Governor, and I know you're going to be delighted to meet him. So please welcome Governor Steve Bullock.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah.
I'm so sorry. I do want to thank First Republic Bank for hosting us today, and for particularly Rowan Dalal, who has made this possible. Thank you so
much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, yeah, thanks, Rowan. Thank you for having me today. And I see the presidential series, so I guess I'm not the only one running for president right now, too. But when you talk about like what the common good is, and really trying to both elevate discourse about sort of the pressing national issues that are facing us right now, I'm glad that you are actually hearing from a lot of candidates, because I think that we are, I don't think this is an overstatement, we're at a tenuous time in this 243-year experiment called representative democracy. And what we choose to do and how we choose to do it not only is shaping the discourse and the discussion of today, but as a parent of 17-year-old, 14-year-old, and 12-year-old, it really is going to be shaping what the future is going to look like, and also what our public circle is going to look like, how we're going to treat one another, how we're going to act and react, and how we're going to be able to engage in public policy. From my perspective, and I know that this is a nonpartisan group, but I mean, fundamentally, for the sake of both our country standing in the world, and this America that we're going to pass on to the next generation, I think we got to make sure that Donald Trump's one-term president. But it's more than just beating him, too. It's really soundly rejecting the behavior that he's normalizing. I mean, I'm glad that you give a shout out to current and lapsed journalists, because as frustrating as in the public eye at times, I'll say this, journalism isn't treating me fairly, how essential it is to really make sure that we're elevating and we're having both a check on government, but having an elevated level of public discourse as well. Soundly rejecting the behavior he's normalizing is the lies and the misstatements, or dividing us by race, by gender, by geography. There's nothing more clear than probably this week, when the whole discussion is about where agree or disagree with these four congresswomen, but from where they came, and using this to try to make us all that much different, it underscores what we need to do if we're going to go forward. And also the Twitter tirades and the temper tantrums. I mean, we fundamentally, at this point, we expect more out of our preschoolers than we do the President of the United States. And I don't think that is the promise of America. I think there's more than that going around right now, too, though, that there are, if you look at it, for most Americans, they're actually working a lot harder and making less today. The average American's making less than they were 40 years ago, adjusted for inflation. Or, and I know this isn't New York City, but imagine two-thirds of the counties in this country have lost businesses over the last decade. And folks are saying, do I have to leave my home, my church or synagogue, my community, just to have a decent living? I was raised in the early 70s. At that time, 90% of 30-year-olds were doing better than their parents were at that age. Today, it's only half. And then folks are saying, well, this isn't working. They look at the political system for relief. And I'll talk a little bit more about that along the way. But they see a system that isn't reflecting their needs, but it's more the donors' needs. $1 billion just since the Citizens United case have been spent by groups that don't even disclose where that money comes from. It was 2% of all spending prior to Citizens United. This last midterm for outside spending groups, over half of this money spent came from groups that don't disclose where they are. Or they see environmental laws being gutted because that's what the polluters ask for, tax laws being written, because literally it becomes a transaction where this is what the donors request. So there's no, I don't think it should be any surprise to any of us that folks are a little frustrated and they're anxious and they're angry. But also, instead of doing something about it, this president's poured gasoline on that fire. We are more divided today than certainly any time in my lifetime. And forget about just Twitter or cable television. You can't even have meaningful conversations around Thanksgiving dinner table or at the local restaurant or coffee shop without politics dividing us. And we're being divided in our communities and our country. And that's not, from my perspective, the promise of America. We are better than that. I'm glad, Patricia, that you're going to dig in along the way to hear people's American story. My American story is a little bit different than some folks probably as well. I lived in New York, so I didn't just fall off the Montana turnip truck. But, you know, was raised in a single-parent household, paycheck to paycheck from sort of grade school through high school, and literally only knew there was a governor's house in town because it's in my neighborhood. But, so I delivered newspapers to it as a kid, so I've literally made it four blocks in life from where I was raised. But, you know, and I worked my way through college. I went to small college outside of Los Angeles, went sight unseen. And then I borrowed my way through law school here at Columbia. I'll never forget that day my wife and I paid off $175,000 of loans in today's dollars. Yeah, it took a lot, but still somehow I had the chance to go from delivering newspapers at the governor's house as a kid to now my wife and I raising our three kids in it. And that is part of the promise of America. And we got to recognize, though, for a whole lot of folks in this country, that no longer exists. And also for a whole lot of people, it never did in this country. So yeah, it's about beating Donald Trump and restoring some discourse. But it's also about making sure that people believe and understand that this economy can work for them, that American dream still exists, and that the political system will as well. I think that folks got to be clear-eyed. Like, if we don't change our strategy, if we can't win back places that we lost in 2016, and if we can't give people a reason to vote for us, not just against him, I think folks should be clear-eyed that Donald Trump will win again. I think it can be done. I've seen it done. Patricia mentioned, so I was the only Democrat in the country to get reelected in a statewide race where in a state where Donald Trump won. Donald Trump in 2016 took Montana by 20 points. I was running against a guy who no one knew until he ran for Congress and got in an altercation with a journalist, this guy Greg Gianforte. It was the most expensive race in our state's history. Donald Trump took Montana by 20. I won by 4. 25 to 30% of my voters voted for Donald Trump. And a lesson along the way to me is if we immediately go in and say, well, we're going to write off areas where it's either hard to win or we didn't win in the past, well, as a party and as a country, things are going to be changing along the way. I don't have the luxury in Montana to go to just those little pockets of blue. I have to go all over this 148,000 square mile state. And I have to make my case, and I have to listen along the way as well. And I think that's what we as Democratic candidates need to do. Because if we can't connect in places like a Michigan and a Wisconsin and a Pennsylvania, as well as connecting places like this, the result's going to be the same. I get that there are 37 people running for president or something like that on the Democratic side. And I only got in about about 7 weeks ago, and I'll never forget. So I announced in my high school classroom that I was in and my daughter's now in. Flew out to New York to do a little bit of press, then went straight to Iowa. So one goes, it's great, Governor, but what took you so long? Now, on the one hand, you'd think when we're still 200 days from any voter expressing a preference that we have a long way to go. But there is the tremendous excitement and energy. And what took me so long is I have a job to do. My legislature right now is 60% Republican. If I had gotten in before that legislative session was over, 100,000 people that have health care through Medicaid expansion, I wouldn't have been able to get that necessarily reauthorized. But in a greater sense, that even in this deeply divided time, I do believe the government can work because I've seen it. My 60% Republican legislature is the best it's ever been as long as I've been governor, meaning that when I came in, it was about two-thirds. Yet we've been able to figure out ways to bridge divides and get meaningful policy that impacts people's lives. Yes, 100,000 folks getting health care, but also lowering overall health care costs by working together. Or record investments in our K-12 system, first-time investments in publicly funded preschool. Fourth lowest tuition and fees in the nation for higher education, because we've actually both been investing in higher ed, and we've turned around and said, well, let's freeze college tuition for 6 of my 8 years. But also recognizing that not everybody goes to college. I've taken 70% of my 2-year colleges and 6 of my 7 tribal colleges, because we have Indian nations out there. It's not even about associate's degree. It's about a professionally recognized certificate or an apprenticeship that gives somebody that opportunity to climb the ladder. As a result, more people in Montana are climbing into the middle class than any other state in the country at a higher rate. So I think that's how government should work. Sure, I try to find common ground, but that doesn't mean I compromise the values that I hold. I also have more vetoes than any governor in the history of Montana. Vetoed every attack on a woman's right to make her own health care decisions, or making it more difficult to access the ballot box, or taking our public lands out of public hands, or interfering with a worker's right to organize and collectively bargain. And the way that I govern and the way that I run for office are much the same. I'll never forget when we were trying to get Medicaid expansion through. This was 2015, which was kind of the heart of the anti-Obamacare time. I went to this town called Shoto, Montana, and Shoto's a town of 1,700 people along the Rocky Mountain front. Everybody in town knew why I was coming, because the Koch brothers, Americans for Prosperity, were kind enough to give a mailing to literally every household with a picture of Bullock and Barack Obama saying, Bullock and Obama are coming to your community to destroy your health care system. But I showed up anyway, and first speaker was a hospital administrator. He said 43% of the people that walk through these doors don't have health insurance. A couple speakers after that got up and called me a socialist or a communist or something like that. Then probably the fourth or fifth speaker, he was the chair of the county commission. He was kind of this grizzled old rancher. He wasn't even from Shoto. He was from Bynum, which is population 50. We'll call that a suburb of Shoto. You know, but he got up and he goes, you know what? I was born in this hospital. This hospital saved my life 2 years ago when I had a heart attack. And if we lose this hospital, folks, this town's gone. So by me going to an area and not telling them what they need, but actually listening to them, and then them being able to speak, is what gave their Republican legislator the courage to defy the Koch brothers, defy their party leadership, and vote to expand health care at a time where every single vote mattered. So then we went from 20% uninsured to 7% today. Or if you look at it, a quarter of the rural hospitals in this country are at risk of closing. We haven't lost one. That's how government ought to work. I think that DC could learn a lot from Montana. I'm not going to say it's going to be easy, and I know for those of you that haven't been there, Montana, it's just a small state somewhere, bigger population than Delaware or Vermont, I'm just saying, as examples. But until we address the one thing that's holding us back in so many ways, everything that we're talking about making D.C. work, it's that much more unlikely. And that really is this toxic influence of money in our elections. Think about it. Lindsey Graham literally said, we have to get this tax cut through to make our donors happy. At the same time that 44% of Americans wouldn't have $400 in their pocket to cover if their car broke down or a medical emergency. A generation of workers have been replaced by independent contractors. Same time that union membership's half of what it was in the 1980s. Drug companies invest big in our political system.
We pay more for prescription drugs and healthcare than any country in the world, and we have nothing to show for it. And at the same time that oil companies are making record profits, Republicans can't even acknowledge that the climate crisis is real anymore. So we do have to address this piece, and I do believe that we can do it. I was, and Patricia alluded to it, so I was Attorney General before I was governor when this little case was taken by the Supreme Court called Citizens United. And Citizens United equates corporations with people and money with speech. I wrote the brief as AG, and even we had Republican attorneys general signing on. We had the majority of states saying, you know, the vast majority of elections actually happen at the state and local level. And it shouldn't be about money there. And the court came down with its decision. Every state in the country said there's nothing they can do, game over. And think about it, even at the time, Democrats controlled both houses of Congress and the presidency, and people spoke about it. They gave speeches about it. They raised money off it, but they didn't do a thing. Montana, I knew that we had to do more because of the history that Patricia mentioned. Around the turn of the century, we had these, we called them copper kings, wealthy copper mining barons that literally controlled every local, state, and federal elections. And they did it with their money. Mark Twain even talked about one of them, William Clark, said, you know, that Clark buys politicians like most people buy food. By his example, corruption no longer has an offensive smell in Montana. And finally, folks said, enough's enough. And in 1912, they passed this act called the Corrupt Practice Act of 1912. They did it by ballot initiative. And that said the corporations can't spend or contribute in our elections. All of a sudden, a state that was completely captured by these mining companies, where headlines were at the time, the greatest living issue confronting us today is whether the corporation shall control the people or the people shall control the corporations. All of a sudden, when that passed, though, it actually became about the individuals. Elections became about talking to one another, not how much money you're raising, about that discourse that we expect. So when Citizens United came down, I knew I had to work to preserve that law. Took the first case post-Citizens United up to the Supreme Court. In building that case, I got testimony from Republicans, former Republican office holders, who had said just the mere threat of all this outside spending could shape what happens in the state house. I was excited about it. 5-4 decision. The U.S. Supreme Court throughout 100 years, oh, 5 minutes, keep moving, fantastic. 5-4 decision, U.S. Supreme Court throughout 100 years of Montana history. Taught me two things, one of which don't ever doubt what one Supreme Court justice can do for when it comes to our democracy, workers' rights, women's rights, gerrymandering, so many issues. It also taught me, though, that you can't just give up and have to double down again. And so I went back to my legislature, which at the time was about 2/3 Republican. We passed a law that said 90 days out from an election. I don't care if you call yourself Americans for America for America. I don't care where you're from. You got to disclose every single dollar you spend in the election. And I'll never forget when I was running for re-election in 2016. 91 days out, Americans for Prosperity, the Koch brothers funded group, mailed all over the state where, you know, my kids looked at it and said, boy, Dad, are you really that bad a guy? But then day 90, it stopped. Like, all of that dark money spending stopped. And if we can do that in Montana, we can do it in New York, in Washington, D.C., everywhere. That's part of how we start bringing this whole system back. So I noted, at least this is the most important election in my lifetime. It's about both beating Donald Trump, but it's about preserving this experiment in representative democracy. If we can't give people a reason to vote for us, not just against him, if we can't win back places that we lost, if we can't make sure that everybody believes whatever their station in life is, that things could actually get better and they have a fair shot at that better life, we're not going to win. I'm an optimist. I have 3 young kids. You have to be optimistic, right? But that's also, I think, part of the spirit of who we are as Americans. We know that we're actually at our best when all voices can be heard, not when we're dividing into warring camps, or when civility can replace anger, or that we know we're at our best when everyone, no matter who their parents were, where they were raised, believes that their life can be better than the generation that they followed. And I do believe we can be that country again. That's what got me into this. That's what keeps me excited about it. And I both appreciate you having me here. And at the end of the day, too, if you decide that there's something about Steve Bullock that we need, I'd also appreciate your support along the way. So I'll stop there before you give me the big red hand. Thanks so much for having me.
One of the best parts about this is our opportunity for people to ask some questions.
Oh, you didn't tell me that was going to happen. I'm leaving.
We're just
please
hit you with it right now. But so we're going to open it up to the floor if anybody has any questions for the governor.
Oh, Mike's gone. Yes, sir.
So how did you win in Montana, the red state? I mean, what was it, personality or issues? Or?
Well, I think that, look, and one of the things that actually got me into this was, because this wasn't my lifetime aspiration, I was asked to travel quite a bit after the 2016 election. And when I'd say 25-30% of my voters voted for Donald Trump, the immediate response was either, what's wrong with those voters? Or a little skeptically, like, what's wrong with you, Bullock? You know, what made that happen? Not ever, how is it the Democrats now aren't always connecting with folks that we ought to? I think how I won is, in part, I said, I have to go out across the entire state. I have to engage. And I think people believe that even if they disagreed with me on a lot of issues, that I wake up each day saying, how can I make their lives better? And I'm not above the overall system. Now, the naivete isn't that you can go run for president. If I just go door to door across America, I win, like that human connection. But a good example that relates to it, I mean, and I also begin with the base premise that most people's lives are too busy for politics, right? They're worried, is my kid going to get sick? Am I going to lose the job? But the values that people have, what they actually want, you want a safe community. You want a decent job, a roof over your head, clean air, clean water, good schools, that belief you can do better. And I unite and talk more about those values than the issues that divide us. And I think that helped along the way. I was running for Attorney General in 2008. And it was a crowded primary field. And that was when Obama and Clinton were running against one another. We have a June primary. They thought it could go all the way down to our primary. So the Clintons and the Obamas were all over Montana. Never forget, though, Barack Obama wraps up the nomination. 4th of July comes. He could have been on the vineyard raising money. He could have been dang near anywhere in this country. But he chose to bring his family to this town called Butte, Montana. And Butte is where all those copper kings came from. It's now actually the largest Superfund site in the country. There was zero electoral advantage for him to go to Butte. But it spoke to places like Butte all across this country, that this guy cares about those places. So I think that you can make that connection that bridges some of the partisan divide with some folks. You know, I'm not so naive to say we'll all grab hands and skip through buttercup fields and sing We Are the World. But I think that Obama's example of doing that spoke to a lot of places. My ability and opportunity not just to spend the time in the pockets of blue, speak to folks that feel like often the government doesn't care about them and the economy isn't working for them. Yes, ma'am.
Now that you've had a chance to take a look at these other 36 candidates,
yeah.
Where do you see your position or your person being differentiated? Where do you fit in that spectrum of people that you're going to be able to stand out?
Yeah, and it was, I wasn't on the first debate stage. I'll be on in 2 weeks in Detroit. And have hit the polling thresholds to do so, but in part I think that was Well, because I got in late. And also, there was some discussion about the polls that they were qualifying for. But where I fit in, because everybody wants to go these lanes, right? Like, are you the full progressive lane? Are you this lane? Are the, you know, and nobody outside of the political world talks about lanes. They're like, is government going to work? So I've always wanted to say, yeah, I'm in the lane that actually gets stuff done that impacts people's lives. Is that progressive? Yeah, in many ways, it is very progressive. As a conservative, I've had to balance budgets every time. So I look a little bit differently than some folks. Directly, and I don't know the categorization, like if there's a specific issue, like there's a lot of discussion about, well, should we pay off everybody's college debt, as an example. And if the progressive side says, yep, 144 or 1.4 trillion, we ought to, that's probably not me. And it's not, look, college debt has doubled in the last 2 years, or in the last decade. And we've got to make sure that we're addressing college affordability. But we also got to recognize that 68% of people don't even have that two-year degree. So at times the discussions that we're having are kind of disconnected with a whole lot of people's lives. Did that sufficiently answer?
You could probably go on for an hour or so.
Yeah, yeah, on any specific issue, sure. Yes, ma'am.
I'm interested. It's really compelling, but it's Montana, and it's a long way from urban black America. And I'm wondering how you think about that.
No, yeah. And I think it's a real fair question, right? Because like only about 10% of my population in Montana is people of color, and most of them are Native Americans. And you should never compare communities to different communities, and certainly recognize that that opportunity that I had growing up doesn't exist for so many people, and for so many people it really never really has. And I think that we have to have that frank conversation as a country about that. And you can begin from, like, if we talk about healthcare, right? If you're four times more likely to die in childbirth if you're an African American, well, that is a specific disparity that we've got to wrap our hands around and address. Or if you're four times more likely, and you are four times more likely to be arrested for and convicted for a marijuana breed or crime, if you will, if you're African American, then if you're white, and it's exact same amounts of usage. So I think that how I will connect and how I will govern, I mean, first of all, I will never presume that I fully, completely understand somebody else's life journey. But I'll show up and I'll listen, and then I'll take action, recognizing that for a whole lot of people in this country, they haven't had the opportunities that everybody should. That's what I've tried to do in Montana with different communities of color. So struck me when I first got elected, I did a health improvement plan for our entire state, and I learned if you're Native American, you're going to live 20 years less in Montana than non-natives. So we tried to address those specific disparities in so many different ways that I could talk about. Yes, ma'am. Then I'll go.
Governor,
yeah, please.
First of all, thank you for serving.
Thank you.
You've given me a lot of hope today. You mentioned that by listening to your residents, it somehow helped bipartisan issues to come to fruition. How would that translate on a national level?
Yeah, I think that I'm two different ways. One of which is that I do think that we as elected officials and leaders, and look, everywhere I go, I'm supposed to talk, not listen, right? But if you're not actually, if you can't make the connection, hear what people are saying, I think we're in a lot of trouble. And there are times where people just want to be heard, but I'll be darned if you can learn quite a bit along the way. Like, I've done 22 probably town halls in Iowa, or meet and greets. And I hear a lot about trade policy. I hear a lot about healthcare and education. To be honest, not one person's ever raised their hand and talked about impeachment. So part of it really is trying to understand what people's daily concerns are. But more than that, and it is, you know, people say, well, DC can no longer work, right? There's no way. The partisan divides are so significant. I give it that example of Shoto that I went to, but there are probably 20 of those. I try to build relationships with my Republican legislators, but recognizing that that relationship isn't enough. And I think in DC, the idea of making the case, it's all about making the case in DC to the legislators, not to actually make the case to America. The next president, if Mitch McConnell's still the head of the Senate, should spend as much time in Kentucky as he or she should in Washington, D.C. Because that's where, when people feel like they can be heard, that's also when they will be reaching out more directly to their individual members of Congress. And politics becomes localized, not nationalized.
Thank you.
Please. Thank you.
Thanks. I'm guessing the appeal of Donald Trump is probably a mystery to most of the people in this room. But you carried your state by 20 points. So can you explain what his appeal is to the people of Montana? And do you think there's any scenario in which you won't carry your state again?
Just because I won and he won, I'm not going to say I'm a psychotherapist of all of how this works, to be honest. But no, I think part of what the appeal was, right, is that things aren't working, so I'm going to blow up the system, right? I mean, the economy's not working for me. The political system's not working. Drain the swamp, we're going to do it, right? We're finally going to clean up Washington. That frank talk, I think, mattered to people, even though it's swampier today than it ever has been, or that I will fight for your jobs and your life, even though whoever cleans this place tonight paid more in taxes than 60 Fortune 500 companies after the Trump tax cuts. So I think part of it was things aren't working, so I'm willing to blow up the system. I do think, oddly enough, if you look, if it's just about the 16 race, that there was a chunk of the Sanders voters and the Trump voters that were the same people, right? It's not working, we got to completely tear it apart. And this is not to dismiss anything of, like, even what Trump did this week. I don't think that the majority of Trump voters were voting based on race and division. They're voting on, DC doesn't work, let's blow up the system. Yes, sir.
Just following up on that question, I don't know what Montana polling is like, but other similarly situated red states, it would be fair to assume that Trump might win by the same kind of numbers in 2020 that he did in 2016. I have a hard time understanding how, with a living, breathing example like yourself of bipartisanship and how to balance interest and give people a sense that somebody's listening, that more wouldn't be persuaded that there is a different way to vote and you got to vote against him. Those equating what those polling numbers look like today and the living, breathing example they've had is hard for me to reconcile.
No, I think beating him is the number one issue. Let's make no mistake about that. But if you look at places that we lost, people that said, this system's not working, so I'm going to go with this guy. And if all you have to say is, this guy is horrible because he says racist things, because he divides the country, there is a transference where it's like, hell, I had nothing to lose. I went with him. Are they talking about me? Me as the voter. The vast majority of voters don't spend their life watching cable television, or they don't know who their local legislator or representative is. They're just trying to have a better life. So I'm not naive on, I think that we have to figure out a way to make government work, and it's not working right now at the federal level. I mean, I'd blow up the filibuster. We can talk about all kinds of DC reforms that would actually get things moving forward. And I think the number one issue is making sure, I mean, the number one issue and where I began, for the next generation, is making sure that this guy's a one-term president. But if you make it all about him, A, you're feeding directly into what he would like, and B, you're not giving people a reason to vote against him other than, well, I'm some alternative, but it's about him, not about how you, as the Democratic candidate, are going to work with them to improve their lives. Sir, then right after that, then. Yes.
Kevin, I first heard you speak in Newport, Rhode Island, and that's one of the reasons why I came today, because I was impressed with your talk back then at the governor's conference.
Yeah.
And when I look at the Democratic Party, our party, when we've won with governors, Governor Carter, Governor Clinton, and I'm frustrated by a lot of the Washington insiders of our Senate.
Hey, me too. Oh, just kidding.
And I watched the debate. Yeah. They raise their hand. I'm going to get rid of all college tuition. Really? Who's paying for that? We should legalize marijuana everywhere. Well, wait a minute. When I was growing up, we had a strong campaign to stop people from smoking cigarettes.
Yeah. Right?
Now we see friends, family, neighbors dying of opioid. And that's wrong, too. We've got to stop that. But we're going to legalize marijuana.
Yeah.
And you don't even know. Your state police can't even tell you how they're going to be able to give somebody a test if they're driving in Montana, if they're on it. And marijuana today isn't what it was years ago, because it's manufactured in factory buildings more so than in the fields of Mexico. What's your position on that? Everybody seems to be rushing to the progressives, and when we see how Democrats have won in this past election, it was the moderates that won.
So two different things, and then I'll get directly on the question of marijuana. But two different things. Governors actually have to do things, right? I don't have the luxury of just saying, wasn't that a great speech? Or I co-sponsored this bill that went into a press release, but it didn't get anywhere. So I think that there is a difference in experience that you bring to it and a difference in viewpoint. Barack Obama's first-term senator. Last senator before that was John F. Kennedy that we successfully nominated and elected. Now, maybe it's the age of celebrity and cable television. I'm currently National Governor Association chair. Even until I got into this, I kind of avoided cable TV. You know, not a real good idea if you want to run for president, but it was all about the conflict. It wasn't actually about the accomplishment. But I think that voters are also sufficiently discerning along the way. So I think that, you know, like on the one hand, it seems like, oh, this thing is so over already. There's still so much time for people to kind of see those qualitative differences. When it comes to marijuana, and we have medical marijuana in Montana, we have a good program. My perspective on it is the federal government ought to get out of the business and let states make their decisions. Because I think that you have seen, like when Colorado legalized as an
example. Did you sign a bill to legalize it in Montana?
I don't think it would get to my desk, but I probably would. Yeah, I probably would. I think that from the perspective of what we've seen with, I think you're absolutely right, this wasn't the marijuana of yesterday. But I do think that a state-by-state experience of what that is and how it should be done is the best way to go. I wouldn't sign a bill at the federal level to say everywhere it's legalized. Yes, ma'am, then over. Please hear it here. All right, okay, first here, just because I'd said next, then right there. Okay, please.
Most of the journalists and the political commentary suggest the white guy can't win the Democratic nomination.
Sure, why am I here?
You obviously don't believe it. But how do you bring this disparate Democratic Party, both in terms of progressives and the super progressives, et cetera, et cetera, and win over the large block of black voters and women?
And it is one. For one piece, and think about, so guy named Congressman Mo Udall was run for president in the 70s against Jimmy Carter. Doesn't win, but then he, at the national convention, gets up and says, when Democrats organize a firing squad, we usually do it in a circle. Right? So we're really good at having this big group of folks, but then at some point we shoot on one another. Now, Look, and I think that there is incredible energy and incredible candidates all the way throughout. So the best that I can do is say that the voters will make that decision. Do we want, as the head of it, a guy like me or a woman like whichever one of the candidates in the field are that case? And I can't say that I've lived everybody's life. I can talk about work that I've done on gender pay equity is but one example, where it was interesting because when I was running for re-election, I wanted to make part of my campaign on equal pay because I'd done a lot. And initially, the pollster said, oh, you can't do that because that's a Hillary issue, right? But meaning the nationalizing races. So, but the ad that we cut was my daughter and I playing basketball. Her talking about what she wants in the future and what I had done to try to get equal pay for equal work. Meaning also that there aren't any issues out there that should be so big or misunderstood if we can't localize them and bring them home to people's kitchen tables. I think at the end of the day that the voters have to decide who can best both reflect and represent. And I think I have an important voice to add to that. Ms. Ma'am.
Hi, my name is Beatrice Sivas. I'm a horrible developer. I wanted to talk to you about, you know, is the economy stupid? So I'm one of those people who spends a lot of time watching cable while I'm grinding away. And, you know, it's really sad that when you turn on MSNBC, you know, it's coverage of the Democratic Party all day, but when you turn on to one channel of the news, the financial news, the word Democrat never shows up. We're absent from conversations about trade.
Yep.
We're absent from conversations about every aspect of the economy. And to me, of the 20 candidates on the stage, I think the only one who is even beginning, who is thinking about it, is Elizabeth Warren. So I would just want to know, kind of, as a governor, how do you address economic issues? Because I actually do think that I disagree with him in every way, that Donald Trump is brilliant, that he is leveraging true economic anxieties about the future of work, where there are less
seats
in the lifeboat than people who want to get into the lifeboat. And so everyone's going to say, well, I'm going to get into the lifeboat and screw you. And if we don't address the economic issues, he will win. I got it that you don't know about blacks in urban settings, etc., but a job is a job, and I think that's really
good. Well, and I think that's, I mean, where I begin with the frame of saying, why is that anxiety there, right? When 44% of Americans don't have $400 in their pocket, they don't hear us talking. Most Americans, be it in Harlem or Manhattan, Montana, population 1,700. They don't hear Democrats talking about your life needs to be able to get better. And that's where then, certainly in a state like Iowa, where you have conservative farmers and ranchers who literally say, now, even based on his tweet, I could lose hundreds of thousands of dollars. We need to be able to give people a belief and actually believe it, that in the last four decades, when 60% of Americans haven't had a pay increase in real terms, where that money is gone. And I think Elizabeth Warren has framed to a degree. I don't think this can be class warfare, though. This has to be about bringing folks up that government hasn't worked for and that they ought to have a shot at economic opportunities. Montana, as I noted, actually had the greatest growth into the middle class at a rate higher than any state in the country. And the policy then turns around not only about college, but then what do we do with folks that aren't going to go to college? There are 1,000 different apprenticeable fields. We used to think of apprenticeships, work-based learning, as just welding. We started 6 or 7 in healthcare last year, or 2 years ago. We started one in brewing beer, of all things, because we have all these microbreweries. We got to recognize that, yet we have a federal system that won't even provide aid to if somebody's trying to get a better education, unless it's a 2-year degree, not a professionally recognized certificate. You have one apprentice in this country for every 40 college students. When you talk about the anxiety that exists, we spend about 20% on trade adjustment assistance, training people for new things than any European country does. And yeah, you've had in globalization, you've had businesses move to other places. When we're, as a country, 5% of the global population, we can't ignore that. Like, we need to actually be engaging globally, but we also have to recognize in every trade policy agreement, workers and those opportunities have always been the stepchild, and we don't even think about that along the way. Last question. Is this the last question or the next question? Okay. So I think that we are going to fail as Democrats if it isn't largely about can we lift your economic opportunities up, because what he has done, what President Trump has done, I think you're spot on, that anxiety, and then he taps into that that makes it dividing us as a country.
So just wondering about your approach to expanding access to pre-K and STEM education.
And
if you could just talk a little bit about your approach.
Yeah, so I think that 90% of a child's brain's developed before they even enter into kindergarten, right? And if we don't figure out a public model, public funding, to get four-year-olds into a system, and this isn't trying to educate from cradle to grave, but this is recognizing so much emotional, social, and brain development happens before they even enter into kindergarten. So we live in a time where a quality preschool program costs more than college tuition. So we're setting people up for failure if we're not addressing before they even hit into kindergarten. So that's a role that I think that the federal government ought to be playing for a quality preschool program. And with STEM education, at the federal level, you can incent it. You know, 92% of all spending in K-12 is actually done at the local and state level. But we've got to recognize that the economy is fundamentally and substantially changing, and we've got to open up those opportunities for people to see what they can be doing in, and I'd probably add the arts to a STEAM, you know, not just looking at science and technology, but also how you do the overall development. We've done work with both individual mentorships and incenting at the state level in Montana to see more pathways for people. And I think we need to continue that. I think
we have to, we're going to take a couple more. Ready?
Yeah.
You've been very interesting and very impressive. Could you talk a little bit about foreign affairs and immigration?
Sure. Yeah. Foreign affairs first, and then immigration. I'm a governor, right? Yes, I've gone to, and I've had to go to Kuwait and Afghanistan. I've deployed National Guard soldiers on their fourth and fifth deployment that are under me, taking folks across the country and across the world on trade missions. But I think that it's largely about judgment. Priorities start out protecting American people, strengthen our alliances. We're in this strange place now where our post-World War II alliances, our allies are really questioning us. We have to deter our adversaries. We have to promote American values, human rights, democracy around the world. I think what Trump has done is his reflex is to treat our adversaries as allies and our allies as adversaries. And this idea of America first has really become America alone. And we need to, I mean, the next president, and look, Barack Obama had some rebuilding to do when he first came in as well, but have to assure our long-term traditional allies that we are still going to be there and that we know that we're stronger together. I do believe that voters vote on judgment. You know, if we just voted on foreign policy, John Kerry or Hillary Clinton sure would have been president. But we're going to have a lot of work to do there. When it comes to immigration, I think the biggest problem right now with our immigration system is Donald Trump. And then I'll get into that a little bit more. Meaning that right now, he is not only ripping apart families, but he is ripping apart our country and using immigration as the tool to do that. What I would do is, I think Democrats believe in border security. I don't believe in a 18th century solution, a wall. for what's a 21st century problem. We have a bureaucratic challenge that's leading to a moral challenge. When you have 450 immigration judges for 800,000 cases, what I would do if I was president, what I would work to do, assuming that I could get Congress to work with me on those areas that we need to get to work. First, I mean, people that, 3 million that have known no other country than ours, the Dreamers, they need to be able to feel safe and secure here towards citizenship. There's another 8 million undocumented immigrants in this country. Two-thirds of them have lived here longer than 10 years. They need to pay a fine, join the military, get to the back of the line, but have a path to citizenship as well. And you look at sort of the, and it is a moral crisis, I think, and it's an inhumane crisis, what's happening at the border right now. But we also have to ask ourselves, have we exacerbated? I mean, we've reduced our aid, appropriated aid, by two-thirds in the last 5 years to those three Central American countries. So at the same time that we're not processing asylum claims, at the same time that we're having this influx, we're making it that much harder for folks to stay home. It's going to be significant challenges, but it shouldn't be challenges that completely divide us. I don't know if that answered all of your question. Are there other pieces to that?
Sorry, real quick question and response.
Okay, you know, I'm going too long.
Your
yep. I'll try to be real quick responsive.
Okay.
The answer is yes.
Is, so what is your tax policy and what's your policy on creating jobs?
So, yeah, I'm glad we got an hour and a half on that one.
The answer is yes.
Yes, yes. So the tax policy, real briefly, is that I think that, you know, that, look, I do think corporate taxes were too high, but I don't think even corporations wanted it down to 21%. I would bump that up to probably 28%. I think at some point we got to get rid of this distinction between passive and active income. It's only been around for 2 decades. I think you could up the marginal tax rates on individuals by a few points without hurting people too much. I don't believe in the like 90% tax or whatever that might be on individuals. The policy for creating jobs, it really, and as National Governor Association chairman right now, next week I hand over the baton. I mean, my whole last year's initiative was good jobs for all Americans. Looking at, this isn't about a job, it's actually about a job that can pay people a livelihood where they can live. To be able to turn around and say, I guess right then, here's how we'll create all the jobs. I mean, we can try to have a further discussion about that, but the federal government does part of it. The federal government has to incentivize the opportunities along the way. I will close because I'm supposed to. One quick story and then I'm done, if that's okay. That you know, so when I got elected as governor, it had been 40 years since kids, the age that our kids were 6, 8, and 10. Like, I'll never forget, we move in the governor's house. My son kicks a soccer ball, it bounces off a painting. Somebody says that painting's worth $200,000. I'm like, get rid of all the damn paintings, right? Because we got to live here. But my first day of the state, I talked about the difference as an executive, and we haven't seen this in 4 decades. And I said to the legislators, kids learn from our words and our deeds. What we say, and also the actions that we take. And I implored them then that our kids are watching. I believe that to be more true today than ever before. And at some point, I think that this president's gonna have to say, what are we providing that next generation to aspire to and be inspired by? Each one of us are gonna have to answer that question as well. And I think all of you as donors and engaged folks are gonna have to. I think we can be better along the way. Appreciate you giving me time. Also appreciate you joining this wonderful group of folks that I have trying to change the country. Thanks so much.
Thank you.